most people, the word desert conjures up images of lonely sand dunes. There are perhaps 20 different types of desert on Earth, ranging from snow-swept plateaus to cactus-clad mountains. What makes a desert a desert is lack of water.
This is the Arizona desert, and at first glance, this dry, thorny landscape looks incredibly hostile. And it is.
US cavalry officers posted here in the 1880s described this region as the most difficult in North America. But despite its appearance, this is a desert where you can survive. And in this program, I'm going to explore the skills of a people who truly mastered living here, the Apache.
There's a hot wind pushing the temperature close to 100. The ground's baking, and you'll lose at least a gallon of sweat a day. Yet the Apache were perfectly at home here. These photographs, taken in 1886, are the only visual record of Native Americans actually on the warpath. Geronimo was their most famous warrior, who used his knowledge of this environment to fight one of the most successful guerrilla wars ever waged. I've long been fascinated by how a handful of warriors using survival skills could outwit 5,000 troops. Desert hiking can be immensely rewarding, but it's not a place to go unprepared. Obviously, you're going to need basic outdoor equipment, compass, map, and so on. But there are a few items that are considered absolutely essential. You've got to, first of all, be dressed right, making sure you've got long sleeves and good protection from the sun. Good sturdy boots to protect you from the cactus and thorns. Some means of making fire, a mirror in case you have to signal, and a torch with plenty of spare batteries so that you can move safely at night when snakes are about. The most important thing of all is plenty of water. I carry at least 6 liters for a day. With water always in short supply in the desert, little brooks like this one can be a real godsend. But the problem is you can't drink this water as you find it. Slow flowing streams like this harbour cryptosporidium and giardia. The last thing I want on a desert hike is diarrhea and dehydration. So when I'm moving around, what I do is I use a simple filter like this one that sterilises the water and filters it all in one. But bad water's not the only hazard out here. There are giant centipedes that bite, poisonous spiders like this brown recluse, the deadly black widow, fist-sized tarantulas, the venomous Gila monster, and last but not least, swarms of biting ants. It's been a while since I was last here, so I'm taking a quick refresher course on the nasties.
You look like at a place like this, you think about the shade and the comfort in this area, and yet if you came over here and you sat down, you'd be sitting right around. If you check here, you'd be seeing all these little black widows. That's what all of these various burrows are all about.
Yeah.
Also, to be found in an area like this are our most dangerous scorpion, which is called a bark scorpion. Here you go, here's one. Doesn't look like much, but he's got quite a little stinger to him.
In Africa, they say if it's got small pincers, it's got a lot of venom.
That's right. If the animal's pincers are very light, probably all that it's doing is holding its prey while it stings it, and then the venom actually does the killing.
And if he stung you, what would you do?
If he stung me right now, I would try to stay very calm and go and find help by walking out of here and going to a road and trying to flag somebody down. And also, you notice I'm holding him with a pair of pliers, and yet he got out. So, whoops. you don't want to mess with animals you don't know anything about.
Yeah. Don't drop him again.
I'll try not. Did it help your heartbeat any?
I'm not so calm anymore.
Great. I think I'll let you go first. All right.
Ray's colleague Barney Tomberlin has been searching for a diamond-backed rattlesnake to show us, and he's found one.
Wow, it's beautiful.
It's a real nice diamondback.
Looks like he's got a meal in him too down here.
What would happen if it bit you?
If it's a big snake, it can be a dangerous bite. You can have some blood problems, and it swells and gets very ugly and so forth. Then you don't feel good. It's very painful.
The good news is a rattlesnake doesn't always inject venom if it bites you. The bad news is it doesn't always rattle a warning before it strikes.
So a big enough snake with a hard enough bite and it's hot would even go through a pair of relatively heavy boots.
So, okay, tell me the best tips then to avoid getting bitten.
Well, don't play with them. If you see a snake, leave it alone, respect it. But if you're climbing, you have to be aware of putting your hands up on the rock to pick yourself up. There's nothing like lifting yourself up and having a coiled rattlesnake be the object that comes right into eyesight. And that's happened. That's happened to me, and I'm sure it's happened to many other people.
Bad scene to be on eye level with one.
What about where it bites you? How important is that?
That's real important. Most bites are in the arms and legs. I think there was one in Phoenix last year in the face or the neck, and that guy died, and that was a Western Diamondback.
Like you said to Jimmy. I'm going to make a journey in a pacheria, what's now called southern Arizona. The route would have been well known to the Apache. I'm starting at the stronghold of one of their most famous chiefs, Cochise, and heading south to Skeleton Canyon, which was a secret cross-border pass into Mexico. This is the starting place for my journey. I'm standing in Cochise's stronghold. It was from this mountain fastness that Cochise and his Apache warriors could look out with an eagle's eye view of Sulphur Springs Valley and all the surrounding countryside. Well, it may look tranquil now, but if I'd come here 100 years ago, it would have meant certain death. Back then, this was a battlefield. Now it's a virtually uninhabited wilderness that silently carries the scars of the past. All of the skills I'm going to show you are based on first-hand accounts written at the time. Walking through this terrain is really hard on your feet, particularly your boots. For the Apache, with only moccasins, that meant they had to change the soles on them every 4 days or every 100 miles, whichever came first. For running repairs, they had a neat little trick. They used the agave, cutting just behind the spine and pulling it down like this. And I'll show you what they did with that. First of all, just loosen it up like this. Then using the back of my knife, I'll start to scrape off all that pulpy material. And there we are. All these fibers will dry nice and strong. And there's the thorn still attached like a needle. It's lovely stuff. Most Apaches would carry 3 or 4 of these coiled up, dry, down the side of their moccasins, ready for use. Hunted by both the American and the Mexican armies, the Apache perfected hit-and-run warfare, returning from raids to the safety of the mountains, where only the brave or the foolhardy would pursue them. Geronimo said of these times, "We were reckless of our lives because we felt that every man's hand was against us. If we returned to the reservation, we would be put in prison and killed. If we stayed in Mexico, they would continue to send soldiers to fight us. So we gave no quarter to anyone and asked no favors."
Well, this is the southern tip of Dragoons, what I've been heading for. It's been a hard walk to get here, but luckily I haven't seen any snakes. Now, the next part of my journey takes me across that valley, that Sulphur Springs Valley. And the temperature out there, well, that's somewhere in the hundreds, probably 110, something like that. So I'm not going to cross that by day. I'm going to wait till night when it's a lot cooler. 100 years ago, the Apache would have crossed that by night too, not so much because of the heat, but because of the danger of being spotted by soldiers.
For most of the 1800s, Apache were hunted like animals. There was a shoot-on-sight policy. They had a price on their heads.